Yes, and hello once again. I'm Max Rat, and welcome to the Max Rat Deconstruction Zone. Yeah, so it's November 28th, Thanksgiving morning, and I'm here with a new show for you today. The show topic and the name of the show is going to be the JFK Assassination. Yeah, so we had the 50th anniversary of the JFK assassination last Friday, and I was trying to get the show done, frankly, around that time, and my investigation took a little bit of a turn, and I wanted to investigate research a couple more little things, and which will be in the show for you today. And I got a big show ahead of me. I'm really excited about this show because I really feel like it's all come around, and I really feel like this show is going to be convincing and supported well, and I really think that this is what really went down. Rather than keep you in suspense any longer, why don't I just get this show going? Welcome aboard once again to the Max Rat Deconstruction Zone. I'm Max Rat, live from the Rat Hole in New York City. And thanks for coming aboard. I'm going to get this show started. We're talking about JFK assassination on the Max Rat Deconstruction Zone.
The public will shortly be unable to think or reason for themselves. It was meaning by that the form of information that was given to them, the type, the formulas that were in use then in the 1970s, he says eventually they'll be unable to think or reason for themselves. And eventually, he said, they will expect the media to do all their thinking and reasoning for them. Well, that's happened today. That's why people today can't think outside of the programming from television.
Yes, that was a guy named Alan Watt talking about something that Zbigniew Brzezinski said, which has come true, is that people can't think outside of what they're being told on TV. I experience that every minute of the day. That's reality here these days. And I'm asking people all the time to turn the TV off or stop just letting it program you like that and start using your head and start thinking these things through. And with this show today, I've thought this thing through, and I've really looked at things and said, okay, why did this happen? Why did that happen? And I believe that the evidence that I'm going to present to you is very convincing, and it certainly is convincing to me. So let's keep it going from there.
And now a word from our sponsor.
I would like to take this opportunity to express my fondness for Duff Beer.
I'd also like to express my fondness for that particular beer.
A man never drank a Duff in his life.
And that was a Simpsons clip where it was a spoof on the JFK and Nixon debates that they had before JFK beat Nixon in his run for the presidency in 1960. So JFK likes Duff beer, which is the working man's beer, and then Nixon says, oh yeah, I like it too, and then Homer says, oh, he probably never even drank a Duff beer. That's the way they divide people and separate people with Democrat, Republican, even in spoof about JFK and Nixon carrying on.
I didn't begin to study who killed John Kennedy for any personal reason that I thought he was perfect. I was a registered Democrat in those days. I wouldn't support the Democrats now because there is no Democratic Party. There's just one party in Washington, and it's called the Military Industrial Party that Eisenhower warned us about. The Democrats are so infiltrated with agents you can't tell one from the other, and I stopped being a member of the Democratic Party.
The murder of John F. Kennedy was a coup d'etat. People in this country got to stop being in denial, and they got to start realizing that assassinations of presidents happen all the time through history, and generally they are always conspiracies. There's not one person that does it. And it's ridiculous in this country that every assassination that takes place in this country, it's always a lone nut. And it's always done to a person who stands for peace. John F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King, John Lennon. All four of them stood for what? Peace. Ending a war.
We must begin to recognize history as it is happening to us. We can no longer toy with illusions. Our war adventures in Asia are not related to national security in any rational sense. A coup d'etat took place in the United States on November 22, 1963, when President John F. Kennedy was assassinated.
Yes, and that's the damn truth, is that a coup d'etat occurred on November 22, 1963. Our government was officially taken over by the factions that are still running it and still running and still trying to bring around world government that I talked about all the time on my show. It's the same people, folks, going on and on, and the same people do 9/11, the same people who killed Kennedy. And why people think it's some stupid story about some guy who's a communist or the mafia or Frank, what's his name, Giancana, Frank Giancana, whatever his name was, these are all nonsensical, or it was a communist, or it was the white supremacist, or whatever nonsense they tell you. No, this is coming from very, very high up, and you're going to see in the show that the killer was in the Secret Service, I'm going to let the show do its talking for you, but we're talking about conspiracy, you know, but anybody who says anything is a conspiracy theorist. Keep it going.
We face a hostile ideology, global in scope, atheistic in character, ruthless in purpose, and insidious in method. Unhappily, the danger it poses promises to be of indefinite duration. To meet it successfully, there is call for not so much the emotional and transitory sacrifices of crisis, but rather those which enable us to carry forward steadily, surely, and without complaint, the burdens of a prolonged and complex struggle with liberty the stake.
Okay, so there's Eisenhower on his final farewell address before he left the presidency in 1960, and he's your first conspiracy theorist who's telling us we face a hostile ideology of global in scope, dead set on basically enslaving us all, and that's President Eisenhower. He's your first conspiracy theorist of the show.
Let us never tolerate outrageous conspiracy theories concerning the attacks of September the 11th. Malicious lies that attempt to shift the blame away from the terrorists themselves, away from the guilty.
Yeah, George Bush is telling you that we shouldn't tolerate conspiracy theories and lies. You know, we need to believe him. Yeah. Okay, and believe what he tells you. There you go.
There's an organization of shrewd, determined men who have been trying to get control of this country for a number of years. Perhaps you've heard of them.
Oh, you mean the Republicans?
No, we mean chaos.
Chaos?
Yes. A monstrous organization of evil dedicated to the destruction of the free world and the systematic subjugation of every man, woman, and child on this planet.
There you go. Get Smart telling you about that in the early 60s. Keep it going. There's another conspiracy theorist for you.
These nefarious conspiracies about government plots to kill and conspire and lie about it and cover up the real truth. I mean, this stuff is as ridiculous as it has ever been.
Okay, and there's a contemporary Rachel Maddow who's going to tell you, don't believe these crazy conspiracy people like Eisenhower and a stupid, you know, and Max Rad and a stupid TV show called Get Smart. And you know what? Don't believe this guy either.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covet.
Yeah, that would be JFK telling you about the vast conspiracy, but Rachel Maddow is like, oh no.
These nefarious conspiracies about government plots to kill and conspire and lie about it and cover up the real truth. I mean, this stuff is as ridiculous as it has ever been.
Okay, and here's your ridiculous conspiracy theorist again. His name is John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Crazy conspiracy theorist.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed.
Wallowing in racist conspiracy theories and the insane American movement and nutty fringe subculture that nurtures those theories.
Yeah, so JFK is a racist conspiracy theorist, according to Rachel Idiot Maddow, and that's you can be conditioned on the television to say that anybody is telling you about what's really going on, or telling you the truth, basically, is conspiracy theorists, including President John Fitzgerald Kennedy, who I would argue was a very good reason that he may, in fact, have been eliminated. And it's multifaceted, but he as well as Eisenhower, certainly warning you very clearly that that there is a nefarious group that's trying to global in scope and hostile ideology, and JFK was telling you in detail what we're opposed by a vast conspiracy that we need to pay attention to. And then Rachel Maddow was like, no, that's a racist wallowing in a racist crazy subculture of America. No, this is from the top, folks, and I by no means am a wallowing racist subculture, and neither is JFK, neither is Eisenhower. Okay, I would argue that Rachel Maddow is a garbage spewing puppet of the conspiracy perpetrators who are trying to get you to stand down while they destroy your family, destroy your children, destroy your school system, and destroy every single thing that's good in this country and in this world. And while we sit back and believe Rachel Maddow, when people like JFK and Eisenhower are warning us, like, with their hearts, okay? And you know what? Let me play JFK one more time, because let's get this through your head before we go on with the show.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed.
wallowing in racist conspiracy theories and the insane American movement and nutty fringe subculture that nurtures those theories.
I never realized Kennedy was so dangerous to the establishment.
There's just sort of a blanket, oh, these are conspiracy theorists. And so they don't believe the government's reports, so we don't have to pay attention to them.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, proud of our ancient heritage, and unwilling to witness or permit the small undoing of those human rights to which this nation has always been committed and to which we are committed today at home and around the world.
He wasn't yelling about communism. He wasn't talking about crime or them or the crime on the streets or other countries or enemies. If you hear the inaugural address, it'll probably be played maybe on radio stations this week. The enemies, if you listen to his speech, were tyranny, poverty, disease, and war.
Can freedom be maintained under the most severe attack it has ever known? I think it can be. And I think in the final analysis, it depends upon what we do here.
Kennedy was warning us over and over that freedom is under attack. Now, how is freedom under attack? And why is tyranny is his main concern in his inaugural address? That's because this New World Order crowd that's their plan, okay? And that's what Kennedy was speaking out about. That's what got him killed. Let's keep it going.
There are those who are seeking to equate dissent with disloyalty. It's a dark day in our nation when high-level authorities will seek to use every method to silence dissent.
You realize that you're damaging the credibility of the country, possibly destroying it?
Let me ask you, is a government worth preserving when it lies to the people?
You're trying to convince us.
It's become a dangerous country, sir, when you cannot trust anyone anymore, when you cannot tell the truth.
A generation, according to John Kennedy, was supposed to go forth armed with what he referred to as truth and justice and peace in this world. But America, 10 years later, was capable of none of these things. It has been a continuous decade of lies, injustices, and continuous wars. We slumped to the lowest place of the dung heap of nations. In my mind, we will be known as the decade of murders and assassins all over the world, instigated by the same people who killed John Kennedy.
Wake up before you're destroyed. The New World Order is right around the corner, and the men that killed John F. Kennedy are the architects of the New World Order.
Now we can see a new world coming into view, a world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order, a world where the United Nations is poised to fulfill the historic vision of its founders.
Yes, the New World Order are the people perpetrating all these crimes. They're the people who are running things behind the scenes, who drag us into these murderous and evil wars with against humble people from other nations who are being controlled as well, just like we are by a bunch of war hawking mongering criminals, and those are the people who are behind these things. People like Kennedy spoke out about it. People like Martin Luther King spoke out about it. People like John Lennon spoke out about it, and among many others. And those people are eliminated. Okay. Will I be eliminated one day due to that? I don't have as many listeners and viewers as Martin Luther King and John Lennon, but if I did, I promise you, I would probably have to worry about things like that. we have to pay attention to these things, folks, because this is not going to end well. And just because that was 50 years ago, it's gotten progressively worse. And we're now going into an even darker period with this world government and with tyranny and police state and all these things. We'll keep the show going, and we'll tell you about who assassinated JFK as well.
You know, I sometimes think things have gone downhill since John Kennedy died, Senator.
Right. So what we see here is kind of a microcosm of what's happening on the global scale. You've got these banking oligarchs. They've infiltrated countries. They've infiltrated economies. They load up folks with incredible amount of debt. And this causes a chain reaction where, at the end of the day, the bankers end up collecting usurious amounts of interest and completely disenfranchising all the local folks who end up basically as debt slaves.
Slaves are wealth, Commander. The more slaves we have, the more bricks we make.
Americans no longer have the rights even of 19th century slaves.
Let my people go!
The slaves are mine. Lives are mine. All that they own is mine.
We've overcome slavery and civil war.
You're free, children! Run back to your individual countries of origin!
Hey! Those multicultural slave children belong to the Disney Corporation.
They seek to rule a world of slaves and not of peers.
You do not speak like a slave. God made men. Men made slaves.
In the election of 1860, Abraham Lincoln said the question was whether this nation could exist half slave or half free. In the election of 1960, and with the world around us, the question is whether the world will exist half slave or half free, whether it will move in the direction of freedom, in the direction of the road that we are taking, or whether it will move in the direction of slavery. I think it will depend in great measure upon what we do here in the United States.
There you go. In his election, he was talking about, are we moving in the direction of slavery or are we moving in the direction of freedom? He was obviously looking towards freedom, and he was eliminated by the slavery crowd. Do you think that's just something that's funny or kidding around? I don't think so. And just because you haven't become officially a slave in 2013... I would argue that we're way closer to being slaves, if not, and we are slaves now to a very ruthless, criminal, lying, murderous system that knocked down our Twin Towers on 9/11, blamed it on a bunch of boogeymen that they made up. Okay, we're too stupid to pay attention to that. They murdered a great man who was going to try to lead us towards freedom, John F. Kennedy, and they told us some stupid story about another made up guy named Lee Harvey Oswald. Then they kill his brother, and they make up another stupid story about another lone gunman. Then they kill Martin Luther King. They make up a story about another stupid lone gunman. Then they kill John Lennon. They make up a story about another stupid lone gunman. This goes on and on, and everybody thinks, oh yeah, that's gonna be fine, and I'll believe that because it's cool to believe whatever they tell me on TV. Good for you.
Shut up, slave! The modern world is too complex to allow the man or woman in the street to interfere in its management.
I've read the Warren Commission and all 23 books with it. I feel the Warren Commission came up with the solution. It's been 47 years now. Any good investigator will tell you if a conspiracy is committed, it's lucky to last 60 days. This has been going on for 47 years, and there is not one shred of evidence that it was a conspiracy.
Okay, that's a guy named Gerald Blaine, who is a Secret Service agent, who wrote a book with this guy Clint Hill, who was on the car that were supposed to be on the car that day. He was Jackie O's personal bodyguard, apparently. He's out there he's trying to tell you, oh, there's no evidence at all. But no, everybody knows. He's like, if the official story with Oswald and all that crap from the Warren Commission wasn't true, we would know already. No, and this guy is getting paid to lie, and the Secret Service was a very integral part of this assassination, and he's still out there today. He's an old man now. He was a young guy back then in the Secret Service. I will show you in the show today how the Secret Service's blatant involvement, and one thing you'll have to take from that is that if it was the Secret Service involved and not some lone gunman in a library six stories high shooting through trees in an impossible at an impossible angle and with an impossible method of shooting, even if you believe that, then fine, go back to bed and be a moron, okay? But so anyway, this guy Gerald Blaine is just one of the lying power control group, as May Brussel would call him, because he's out there. He's part of this group that's paid to go out there and lie about these things and constantly plant these nonsensical seeds in your head. Oh yeah, it would only take 60 days if it was a conspiracy, and you know, that's how, you know, we figure out that out. No, well, obviously we don't figure it out so fast, because this is an obvious conspiracy to kill the president, and he's telling you, yeah, no, you know, this is no conspiracy, and you believe him. You know, if you believe him, you're an absolute moron.
You're not dealing with morons here.
Nah.
The truth is the most important value we have, because if the truth does not endure, if the government murders truth, if we cannot respect the hearts of these people, then this is not the country in which I was born in, and it's certainly not the country that I want to die in.
That was a clip of, that was a Kevin Costner playing Jim Garrison. I'm not going to get too into what I think of that, although what the JFK movie, the Oliver Stone version, even though I've used some clips from that just to give you context of the show, is mostly a load of crap. But I'm going to make that case for you as we go.
We have been fed one officially sanctioned lie after another, beginning with a blue ribbon cover-up commission to a castrated Senate Select Committee seeking to shed light upon an event deliberately enshrouded in deception, concealment, and outright falsehood.
Why was Kennedy killed? Who benefited? Who has the power to cover it up?
Okay, that was Donald Sutherland in the JFK movie, and that was an interesting little clip where he says, why was Kennedy killed? And who has the power to cover it up? Which is and who benefited? Who benefited was the New World Order, world government, tyranny crowd. Okay, and who has a power to cover it up? Yes.
He's also been described as the chairman of the board of America's ruling class.
Okay, we're talking about David Rockefeller, and he says he's been, and his introducer in an interview that they did introduces him as the chairman of the board of America's ruling class. So so we're acknowledging that there is a ruling class, okay, whatever, and I'm not going to argue that there is. I'm just going to argue that the 99% of the Americans that you talk to don't think, oh, what are you talking about ruling class? Nobody ruling class. We vote for our people. We vote for these people. No. Then he wouldn't be. He's going to be self-described as the chairman of the board of the rulers. Okay, which would be our king, I guess. That's how that might work. Anyway, so here we go. So who has the power to cover it up, and who benefits from the assassination? Here we go.
He's also been described as the chairman of the board of America's ruling class. He has been pilloried regularly by the left and by the right for dancing with dictators and for conspiring to enslave the nation to the machinations of the Trilateral Commission.
okay, he's been they're bragging that he's been accused of conspiring, so he's a conspiracy theorist too, I guess, conspiring to enslave the nation to his trilateral commission, which if you listen to my last couple shows on the United Nations, you might realize that actually that's taking place as we speak. So who covered it up? Who had the power to cover it up? Who benefited from this assassination? Let's just look into that a little bit more now.
The first cover-up of the John Kennedy assassination came with the Warren Commission. John Connally was the governor of Texas, and they were supposed to have a citizens' inquiry there, but immediately people suspected a conspiracy. So President Johnson appointed Gerald Ford, with Leon Jaworski representing Texas on the Warren Commission.
Okay, it's interesting. Gerald Ford, who's later appointed the president. He wasn't elected originally. He was because they Nixon resigned, and I guess that was his reward for being on the Warren Commission. Okay, which, you know, where he participated in a dirty cover up of the Kennedy assassination. And let's see who else was involved in that Warren Commission.
John J. McCloy, president of Chase Manhattan Bank, worked with the Rockefellers all of his life. Alan Dulles, lawyer for the Rockefellers, the Chase Manhattan Bank.
Okay, so those are two more. McCloy and Dulles, who's not only head of the CIA at the time of the assassination, but both of them, McCloy was president of Chase Manhattan Bank, okay, with David Rockefeller was the chairman of Chase Manhattan at the time, because he was for 35 years, and that certainly was part of his tenure there. So McCloy's working for the Rockefellers, Dulles working for the Rockefellers, Gerald Ford is obviously, a puppet of theirs as well. So we got a investigating board that is all, people. The New World Order is appoints to people. So the, what do they call it? The, wolf is guarding the hen house, or so to speak, or investigating the hen house, or investigating, the wolf is investigating himself, or maybe there's a better term, maybe there's a better saying that I missed on that one, but this is, are you kidding me? Okay, let me play that, start that clip again, and then I'm going to keep going.
The first cover-up of the John Kennedy assassination came with the Warren Commission. John Connally was the governor of Texas, and they were supposed to have a citizens' inquiry there, but immediately people suspected a conspiracy. So President Johnson appointed Gerald Ford, with Leon Jaworski representing Texas on the Warren Commission. John J. McCloy, president of Chase Manhattan Bank, worked with the Rockefellers all of his life. Alan Dulles, lawyer for the Rockefellers, the Chase Manhattan Bank, who was head of the CIA until John Kennedy fired him. And there was Senator Cooper and Senator Russell, the watchdog for the CIA in Congress, and Hale Boggs from Louisiana.
Okay, and so Dulles was the director of the CIA, and he was a lawyer for Chase Manhattan Bank. Isn't that interesting?
I know Alan Dulles very well. I briefed him many a time in his house. But for the life of me, I still can't figure out why he was appointed to investigate Kennedy's death, the man who had fired him.
Right, so not only did Kennedy fire him from the CIA, because Kennedy was on to these people, for sure, and he was trying to get rid of all these Rockefeller apparatchiks who were trying to take him down, okay? He fires the guy from the CIA, and then they kill him, and not only then they put the guy who he fired back on the Warren Commission. Isn't that shady enough for you?
Consequently, a whole new form of government is going to take over this country.
Okay, that was the Jack Ruby character from JFK, and he says, consequently, after this assassination, a whole new form of government will take over this country. So that's called a coup d'etat, okay, folks, and that's how it works, and that's what they're telling you right to your face in JFK.
It's not about our well-being, all right? It's not about our two cars and our TVs and your kitchen.
It's about our kids growing up and our shit all lives, and I'm angry about it. And my life is fucked because of it. If you could see it that way, Liz, you see that your life is fucked too.
Here we go, the greatest fairy tale ever told. It's got everything. The Prince of Camelot, rubies, and magic bullets. The gloomy, overcast sky had given way to bright sunshine as Air Force One touched down in Dallas. Lee Harvey Oswald purchased a Coca-Cola from a vending machine and was preparing to eat a chicken lunch. The president's motorcade proceeded through downtown Dallas towards Dealey Plaza.
Why is it called Dealey Plaza anyway?
Excellent question, Joseph. Doesn't really say here. We could see appendix, but that's what's been keeping the kitchen table from wobbling all these years.
If we're gonna fool these people, it has to be big.
Is there somewhere in town where I can get a good, clear shot or view of Kathy Lee?
You know, I think the book depository would be a good bet. I think the book depository would be a good bet. Book depository. Depository. Book depository. Book depository.
All right, so in South Park, they're doing a little spoof with, he's trying to assassinate Kathy Lee Gifford, the Mr. Garrison, and so he's trying to assassinate her, so the cop tells him, well, why don't you, he's like, where can I get a good shot at her, and the cop from South Park says over and over and over, try the book depository, So what that does is keeps planting that the idea that the shooting took place from a book depository, which is nonsensical, and I will prove that to you in this show clearly, that there was no shot fired at all from Lee Harvey Oswald or the book depository. That's all nonsense. That's all garbage for your consumption because you want to believe some garbage about. And he was drinking a Coca-Cola and he's eating a chicken lunch. That was all those are things that Americans like, oh, I drink a Coca-Cola for lunch today. So that must be true then.
You know, it's just that you keep talking about things. You keep saying it over and over and over again, and eventually people believe it.
I think Oswald's a good old-fashioned decoy. What'd he say? I'm just a patsy. You better believe it.
All right, so a decoy and a patsy, I would argue, are two different things, okay? Decoy, yes. Patsy, patsy means that he was actually involved somewhat in this whole thing, and he's blamed for something. I would say he's a decoy, okay? Because patsy means he had some sort of significant involvement, and there is no evidence of any of that now. So now we're gonna have Oswald himself. Now you're just arrested for murdering the president, and he's gonna say first of all he's gonna be cool as a cucumber. He's like I don't even know what I'm being charged for. I'm like, dude, you're on TV. Okay, and again, you know, why do we have these people on TV? Why this guy doesn't? He's being charged with the most serious crime you could possibly be charged with, and he's going to be on TV doing and they're interviewing him right away, and not only that, but they know who did it right away, and he's going to say with all this there's like press people surrounding him, and he's going to say, well, I don't even know what I'm charged with yet. I mean, come on, whatever. This is so nonsensical. Okay, this is so. Here's Oswald himself, and he's like, yeah, it's like, you know, well, I don't even know what's going on really.
I really don't know what the situation is about. Nobody has told me anything except that I'm accused of murdering a police officer. I know nothing more than that.
He's like, I was accused of murdering a policeman. I don't know what's going on here. I'm like, dude, why do you think you're being interviewed on TV by thousands of people? And I'm like, how do they make him available for an interview even? I mean, isn't he supposed to be, so they're bringing him into the station house, and not only that, but the press already knows he's on his way. They already got him, or they got the culprit, and he's already there. And then they go, what are they going to stop and say? Okay, why don't you give a few interviews? I mean, that's so ridiculous. Okay, but that's what we like to believe. We like to believe garbage like that. That it's so convenient for them to give him an impromptu. And he's like, he's giving interviews right now. Like he doesn't have other things on his mind.
Just maybe Oswald is exactly what he said he was. Patsy.
he doesn't have to tell you that he's a patsy either. Okay, this is all patsy. Obviously, no. Oswald is your boogeyman. Oswald is your Osama bin Laden, your fabricated boogeyman, and why people would ever want to believe that story, I have no idea. So anyway, so he's like, I don't even know what I'm being charged with. Okay, but he's doing interviews on TV and he's not even nervous or anything. Whatever. So let's here's Oswald himself again on the same day that he was arrested.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
Okay, so the guy goes, "Did you kill the president?" And he's like, "Oh, I didn't even know. I wasn't even charged with that." So he didn't even answer the question, which is bizarre. Well, not bizarre, because he's obviously been trained and coached to act like this, and he's giving interviews like the people who arrested him didn't just walk him right into the police station or whatever and lock him up. Come outside for a second and we'll give you, you can do some quick interviews on TV. And then the press knows that he's there because he killed the president, supposedly. He's like, "Oh, I didn't even know that." I mean, this is so nonsensical. Okay, but again, I know people at the time and still, because it's just like it is now, where people continuously believe this. And so we got a bunch of murdering criminals who are knocking down the buildings on 9/11, killing the president, and giving you garbage, stupid stories. And we are just still, after 50 fucking years, we're still there believing the same stupid garbage. It's just pathetic. And like I always say, can't possibly end well. And it's not ending well. It just gets worse and worse. And I'm glad that I'm getting older now. So because I wouldn't want to be a kid now in this world, because it sucks. Okay, it's gonna suck, because what we have is more police state and the criminality is rampant. Keep it going.
You've got other conspiracies, Dale. You got,
aliens!
That's right, you got aliens. Why don't you tell us about how the aliens are gonna do things?
Don't you patronize me. I gotta go to Dallas. I need to figure this thing out.
Okay, so again, the one guy who questions the Oswald story is, you know, they're like, "Why don't you talk about anything? You know, go follow your alien." He's a nut, an alien conspiracy nut. And I just told you that JFK himself called it a conspiracy, and so did Eisenhower. I don't want to hear that if you don't realize that this is a conspiracy, you're an absolute moron if you believe it's not a conspiracy. There isn't a conspiracy going on to enslave your stupid ass and to kill your kids and to wipe out the family and to indoctrinate kids into more robots and slaves. Okay, if you don't think that's obvious, but we're still going to war, and because we have to go kill people in Afghanistan and kill the boogeyman in Pakistan and Osama bin Laden and Al Qaeda. You see, we're still believing that garbage. Oh my goodness!
Nobody's gonna tell me that kid did the shooting job he did from that damn bookstore.
So you take this car, Carcano, one's worst shoulder weapon, and you try to hit a moving target at 88 yards through heavy foliage? No way. Yeah. FBI tried two sets of tests. Not one of their sharpshooters could match Oswald's performance. Not one. And Oswald was at best a medium shot. The scope was defective on it, too. I mean, this is the whole essence of the case to me. The guy couldn't do the shooting. Nobody could. And they sold this lemon to the American public.
Sold that to the American public, and we bought it. And I would give you the comparison of of they're saying and many dozens of people have said, you couldn't have fired a gun that fast, you couldn't have fired that accurate, you couldn't shoot through a tree, it was a horrible angle, it was far away, but people insist on believing it, and you know, even though that's, the odds of that being possible are zero, okay. And the same thing with the with 9/11, with the planes, people are like, oh, they flew planes faster than planes could fly at altitudes faster at thousands of feet. No plane has ever flown 500. No plane that size has ever flown 500 miles an hour, and never will. And then melts into steel. Then aluminum cuts through steel, and not even like a tiny piece of anything breaks off of the plane, and it goes in whole into the building, and we all believe that too. And it's impossible. Okay, period. Okay, and it was impossible for anybody to. They just said that the FBI did two separate tests. Nobody could do it. Same thing, if you remember my 9/11 show when they tried the, flight simulators, and nobody could do that either. Okay. It couldn't be done, but some guy who's untrained and not the, best in the world can do it. And then the best people in the world can't never do it. Okay. And the physicist will tell you it's physically impossible also. And then we continue, but I'm a conspiracy theorist. And Rachel Maddow's like, oh no, you're a racist, wallowing in racist conspiracy theory. Why? Because JFK warned us and Eisenhower warned us. And now we're believing some garbage, stupid story again and again and again. This just goes on and on. I'm going to pound away at that, but let's get back to the assassination. Here we go.
Lewis pregnant. I didn't think the fat man still had that kind of marksmanship, but that's what they said about Lee Harvey Oswald. Hey, Mr. President! Mr. President, up here! I voted for you! Wait a minute. That guy on the grassy knoll's got a gun. He's going to shoot the president! Holy smokes, I've got to do something! All right, Lee, time to become an American hero.
Okay, so that's a Family Guy little clip. So now what they'll do with that one is they'll make fun of Lee Harvey Oswald, and then they'll try to plant, like, oh no, like the grass, oh, you should believe that other stupid story they told you about the grassy knoll. Nope, that's wrong too. Okay, so again, you're being downloaded with lies that you'll have a very difficult time kicking out of your little tiny brains, okay, because you were downloaded on Family Guy or some other entertainment type show that you think is entertainment, but it's not entertainment. It's made to download you with nonsense, okay, because you have so difficult time deciding what's true and what's not on the TV. That's how they're giving it to you. So now you're going to be like, oh, they're making fun of Lee Harvey Oswald, but they're going to talk about the grassy knoll. So that must be the real story. No, that's not the real story either. Okay, keep it going.
Sure, three experts, and not one of them could do it. They're telling us that Oswald got off three shots with world-class precision from a manual bolt-action rifle in less than 6 seconds.
Okay, so again, so they're going to tell you in JFK that was Walter Matthau, the great Walter Matthau, and they're going to tell you in JFK that they're going to make it, you know, they're going to raise the doubt that Lee Harvey Oswald couldn't have done it, which is true. But then if you watch the movie, they go on and on about how he's a communist in here, and all these other characters, all these colorful characters, and they're gay, and all kinds of stuff that people just gobble down. And in the meantime, none of it, you're not really getting anything. you're just getting a runaround, you know, and you're getting a nice story about gay people and sex and drugs and communists and all these other nonsensical things, and then you'll never hear anything about the truth at all. But let's keep it going.
People accept the phony for the real.
Oh yeah.
It takes a minimum 2.3 seconds to recycle this thing. The other problem is there was a tree there blocking the first two shots.
It's true. It's called the sniper's nest. It's glassed in. It's got the boxes sitting there. You can't actually get to the window itself. And the reason they did that, of course, they didn't want thousands of American tourists getting there each year going.
No fucking way! I can't even see the road! Shit, they're lying to us! Fuck! Where are they? There's no fucking way! Not unless Oswald was hanging by his toes, upside down from the ledge. Either that or some pigeons grabbed onto him, flew him over the motorcade. Surely someone would have seen that. You know, there was rumors of anti-Castro pigeons seen drinking in bars. Someone overheard them saying, coo, coo, coo.
He was arrested that day for fighting with some anti-Castro Cubans.
Okay, so he's there drinking in bars with anti-Castro Cubans, and same thing, so 9/11, they're drinking there at strip clubs, the hijackers, and they run the same stories over and over at you, because they, yeah, that shit worked last time, let's just do it again, you know, these people love this crap.
For years, I've been listening to all these idiots on bar stools with all their pet theories on Dallas. How was the Cubans, CIA or the white supremacists or the mob, or whether it was one weapon or whether it was five.
Okay, so that's that was Clint Eastwood in a movie called In the Line of Fire, which was about a Secret Service agent. I think he was emulating this guy or he was supposed to be this guy Clint Hill. And so, and he's, and you know, he's a patriotic American, and he protects the president, and he's always trying to protect the president, and he's gonna say, you know, all these people have sitting on bar stools talking to bars about all these different theories, and he doesn't give you any theory that the Secret Service did, of course not. So that movie was about trying to deflect attention off of the Secret Service, because I'm going to tell you right now that the driver of the car, the Secret Service agent William Greer, was the shot the fatal shot that blew Kennedy's head off. That's going to be clear. I'm going to prove that's outright provable. It's clear as could be. So now we have to deal with all these Secret Service agents telling you how great they are and how they're not, and they'll plant it in you with something in the movies, because you believe everything in the movies, you believe everything that's on TV, so they'll, you know, and, or you're being downloaded with fictional or what you perceive as a entertainment mechanism. When it's really not an entertainment mechanism, it's a propaganda mechanism. But you're convinced. No, this is for my entertainment with Clint Eastwood, man. He's the greatest. He's for Dirty Harry and everything. And that's not what it's being used for. So he's going to tell you that oh yeah, that's again anybody who doesn't believe the official story and he doesn't want you to start using your brain to put things together. So because then you're going to find out that he was he the character that he's playing was really the one, the culprit, and the one that was involved in the murder and assassination of our president, just like And those are the same people, the people he's working for, the same people who knocked down the buildings on 9/11 and then drag us into all these criminal wars for their own benefit and to fleece the American people and kill and get us all killed and maimed and destroy us, okay? That's what this is for. Keep it going.
The greatest messages are promoted through movies and drama, high drama, through the fixation of emotive sequences, emotional sequences, not logical, factual sequences, but pushing points across in an emotional way which register and fix in the mind. So emotional content is very, very important, rather than going through an actual discussion or an argument using logic and facts. There's no debate. And when you're being downloaded through fiction, your guard is down, the sensor part of your brain is not in action. It isn't saying, yes, I agree with this, I disagree with that, as you would in a debate or a lecture. You're actually in an alpha state, being completely downloaded with new ideas.
And right, you're it's the Family Guy telling you about Degrassi Nolan, about Lee Harvey Oswald from the Book Depository. Then you got South Park, the Book Depository. Then you got In the Line of Fire with Clint Eastwood telling you, yeah, man, you know, there's a bunch of these people who like have all these stupid theories, and then the theories he brings up are anti-Castro Cubans and different weapons and stuff like that. Like, oh, that's all crazy talk, right? And then JFK's like anti-Castro Cubans and the mob and in Cuba and all kinds of, you know, they're the ones who want to kill Kennedy, and they shot him from the grassy knoll again. And this is ridiculous. You believe me? Well, you don't have to fuck believing me. The evidence is so much more clear that this is coming from way higher up than some nonsensical anti-Castro Cuban garbage, okay? This is coming from the evilest people who are running the world behind the scenes, from the Queen of England down to with the Rockefellers and the global banking cabal and all these things. That's who's doing these things, folks. Those are the ones who profit, who benefit from these wars and have the power to cover it up, okay? Not anybody else. And you gotta be a moron to not understand that.
Kennedy was not killed by a lone gunman.
Tell me, brother. Let me believe.
Kennedy wasn't killed at all. He dropped out of a false bottom in the limo and is now an easy listening DJ in northern Michigan.
There you go, and that's to show you that anybody who doesn't believe the official story is a crackpot.
People don't yet know that they've been had. They will disagree with everything I say, but they haven't examined the documents. And that's a very pathetic situation to be in. Now,
that's a very pathetic situation to be in when you don't even know you've been had, and you'll just disagree with everything because it wasn't on, you know, people on TV told me that you're crazy, so I'm believing that. All right, and that's a pathetic situation for you.
The Warren Commission's case against Oswald centered on the celebrated theory of the single bullet that allegedly went through both the president and Governor Connally to emerge virtually unscathed.
I turned and the spit ricocheted off him and it hit me.
Wow, what a story.
Unfortunately, the immutable laws of physics contradict the whole premise of your account. Allow me to reconstruct this, if I may, for Miss Bettis, as I've heard this story a number of times. Newman, Kramer, if you'll indulge me. According to your story, Hernandez passes you and starts walking up the ramp.
Mm-hmm.
Then you say you were struck on the right temple. The spit then proceeds to ricochet off the temple, striking Newman between the third and the fourth rib. The spit then came off the rib, made a right turn, hitting Newman in the right wrist, causing him to drop his baseball cap. The spit then splashed off the wrist, pauses in midair, mind you, makes a left turn, and lands on Newman's left thigh. That is one magic loogie.
Okay, so that was Seinfeld that did a kind of a comical show about the Kennedy assassination, where they were talking about they were at a Met game and somebody spit on Kramer, and it ricocheted off Kramer and hit Newman, and so they kind of go into the area of the second shooter and the bullet, the magic bullet. And let's just elaborate on that as we go. Here we go.
Let us call him the Umbrella Man. You can see him in the certain frames from the Zapruder film, standing right there by the Stemmons freeway sign. There are other still photographs taken from other locations in Dealey Plaza, which show the whole man standing under an open black umbrella. The only person under any umbrella in all of Dallas, standing right at the location where all the shots come into the limousine.
Okay, now that was the interesting turn that came up when I was doing my investigation. Funny enough, so there's a guy with his umbrella. He's standing right on the edge of the road as the car goes by, very close to the car. I would say how close? I mean, maybe 20 feet, maybe less. They tell you one of the clips said 26 yards. It was nowhere near that far. It was very close. And he, not only that, but he's standing next to that sign, or the sign that they must, like, it looks as though they put that into the Zapruder film. The thing, okay, so now the thing that's gonna, I'm going to discuss with that is that, look, when Kennedy came past that sign, if you watch the Zapruder film, when the limo's coming past that, the umbrella man's standing right there, and all of a sudden, Kennedy gets hit and he grabs his neck. Okay. Now the issue that I always had with that was that because I used to think, like, because the driver of the car turns around after and blasts Kennedy, which I'm going to get into in a second. I thought, well, maybe the passenger seat agent Kellerman was shooting at them from, like, on, you know, under the seat, under his arm, you know, while the other guy was driving. But the thing is that the way that Kennedy gets hit, it doesn't look like, he certainly wasn't hit by a high power rifle, because that would have blew him halfway across the car. And not only that, but it would have the whole car would have started, everybody would have been scrambling, you know. In this case, he gets hit in the neck, and Jackie is unaware that he gets hit in the neck, and then they showed a picture from the autopsy of the hole in his neck, and it was a rather small hole. It was not a bullet hole looking hole. Now, if you want to argue with me, well, maybe that's, you know, that autopsy picture is fraudulent. That's possible too. But the one thing that we do know for sure is that he did get hit in the neck with something, because he reacted to it like that, and he did get hit, he put his hands up. He was like, "Ow, my neck." And, like, again, if that was a high-power rifle from anywhere, or even a gun from in the front seat, it would have been a much more devastating reaction, or the bullet itself would have jolted him across out of the seated position that he was in, and Jackie certainly would have noticed that a little bit more, so they're going to tell you, well, so this umbrella man standing there. And as this guy tells you, which is true, that the minute he drives past that umbrella man, there, all of a sudden everybody's hitting the car, okay? Or there was people being hit in the car. So let's go from there. So here you go. So you got the umbrella man. Let me play that one again.
Let us call him the umbrella man. You can see him in the certain frames from the Zapruder film, standing right there by the Stebbins Freeway sign. There are other still photographs taken from other locations in Dealey Plaza, which show the whole man standing under an open black umbrella. The only person under any umbrella in all of Dallas, standing right at the location where all the shots come into the limousine.
There you go. And interestingly, in the Seinfeld spoof, when they show Kramer getting hit, which was kind of with the spit and stuff, there's a guy with an umbrella standing right there, which is kind of so they certainly weren't didn't forget to put that one in there either, even in the Seinfeld spoof, if you go watch that again. So let's move it forward. Let's keep it going. I'm going to try to bring that all together for you. So this is the first hit. This is not the kill shot where his head blows up. Now, do you want to tell me that when you say, though, maybe it wasn't... Well, let's just keep it going. I'm going to discuss that first.
Now, before he goes behind the sign, the president is waving to the crowd. When he comes out from behind the sign, he is shot. Then Governor Connolly is shot.
He's already been hit.
Right, and the guy in the, and that was on the Geraldo. Geraldo was the first guy who played the Zapruder film on American TV. And that was literally 12 years later, okay? He happened in 1963. They played that in 1975. That was the first time we saw it. So the first time the American people ever saw the Zapruder film was 12 years later. Isn't that a convenience, you know, to me, too? So people didn't have any information for 12 years, and you wonder why things can be covered up for so long? That's a good start. That's a good start. Geraldo, the guy in Geraldo is Okay, so the guy, they say he got hit right after he came behind the sign. The if you'll notice, the umbrella man standing right next to, in front of that sign, right next to that sign. I don't even believe that sign is real for a lot of reasons. I'll get into that as well. Keep it going.
It has been argued by John Costella, Ph.D., that the Stemmons Freeway sign, which passes in front of the limousine, has been fabricated.
Okay, one of the reasons that right away is that this sign, supposedly it's a street, it's a street sign to, you know, for cars to look at while they're driving. It's parallel to the road, okay? And a street sign should be perpendicular to the road, because otherwise you'd have to turn your head off the road, away from the road to see it, okay? And it's literally parallel to the road, and it looks very awkward. And why is anybody, Zapruder, would sit behind a street sign like that? And it just doesn't make any sense. And there is a lot of reason to believe that's part. And the Zapruder film was blatantly altered. And that's part of it. They couldn't alter it all because they needed to get the shooting in there and all these other things in there. They need to show you what happened, or at least Zapruder was supposedly filming what happened. Anyway, so the umbrella man is standing right next to the street sign. Keep it going.
That's some bullet.
Okay, that's some bullet.
Anyone who's been in combat will tell you, never in the history of gunfire has there been a bullet this ridiculous. Yet the government says it can prove it with some fancy physics in a nuclear laboratory. Of course they can. Theoretical physics can prove that an elephant can hang from a cliff with his tail tied to a daisy. But use your eyes, your common sense. The Army wound ballistics experts at Edward Arsenal fired some comparison bullets. Not one of them looked anything like this.
Okay, so they're telling you, first of all, that about theoretical physics, which is, I believe, a nonsensical bunk science that we've been presented with. And I'm going to get back to what he just said, but let me show you the foremost theoretical physicist we have these days is a guy named Michio Kaku, and here's a little clip from him.
The mind of God in this picture would be cosmic music resonating throughout 11-dimensional hyperspace.
Far out, man. That was Michio Kaku. He's talking about the mind of God. He's a theoretical physicist. So anything from anybody who calls himself a theoretical physicist is a crock of bullshit too. So now back to the JFK, where he talks about the magic bullet. He says that they tried tests with bullets and none of them reacted that way. The other thing is, but the argument here is that there wasn't a bullet fired from that. Umbrella, and I'm going to get into that right now. You're going to see what I mean by that.
The Secret Service man who was sitting in the front seat who said a flurry of bullets came at us, and the commission said, you mean two or three? He said, gentlemen, I've been in this too long. It was a flurry of bullets.
Okay, kind of a flurry is a weird way to describe bullets. There is sort of no evidence that there was, like, because when he came past that street sign, he was hit with something in the neck for sure, and Connolly looked as though he was hit too right away, and that's what I believe is the description of flurry of bullets. So I'm gonna play the next two clips, and then we're gonna talk about that, what that reads to me.
A single bullet now has to account for the remaining seven wounds in Kennedy and Connolly. But rather than admit to a conspiracy or investigate further, the Warren Commission chose to endorse the theory put forth by an ambitious junior counselor, Arlen Specter, one of the grossest lies ever forced on the American people. We've come to know it as the magic bullet theory.
Okay, and the story of the magic bullet is that not only did it go into two different people and hit them in seven different spots in their bodies, but then it actually just fell out of whoever, I guess Kennedy, and was lying next to him on the gurney when he was in the hospital, the morgue or whatever. So not only did it go through two people, but then it popped out and just lies there, and it was unscathed. The bullet didn't have any damage to it, which is impossible again. And then, so why anybody, why is that even being considered, that is, why isn't that being considered some sort of a foul play rather than being considered legitimate? Because what? Because Arlen Specter, some liar who's such a scumbag liar that he couldn't even capitalize on being on lying about the Kennedy assassination. Like he didn't even get a bigger reward than just being a senator for the rest of his life because he's that's what kind of a slime bag he is and he always was. But anyway, so the bullet, not only does it go through two people and it hits seven different spots in the body, but it also pops out unscathed and lying there next to him on a gurney, and we believe, isn't that nice that we believe that? So now, back to the Umbrella Man. Here we go.
Robert Cutler is charging that the man holding the umbrella was part of a conspiracy to kill JFK.
Okay, and by the way, this is a young Bill O'Reilly. I didn't even recognize him. And then I was like, oh shit, that's Bill O'Reilly. He's like, looks like he's in his late 20s or something here. And he's talking with a guy who's convinced of that the Umbrella Man was firing, darts, and people have called them poisonous darts. But, one thing that I'm a little curious about that is that if it was poisonous darts, and it hit Connolly, then how come he wasn't poisoned as well? But we do know that something went into JFK's throat, and the idea of a dart makes perfect sense because, like I said, it didn't look like it was a gunshot because he wasn't jolted or and he just grabbed his neck. He was like, "Ow, my neck!" And then Jackie looks over and is like, "What's wrong? What's happening?" So it didn't seem like there was a. Nobody seemed to be aware of any gunshot. It did seem to seem like it was a very, almost a stealth type of a thing. But it certainly did seem as though there was a bunch of them that flew into the car and that hit JFK and Connolly in several different places. Maybe there was some sort of antidote that they gave to Connolly. I don't know. Let's keep going.
Hey. Cutler, a Massachusetts architect and Harvard graduate, has been researching the JFK assassination for 13 years and is convinced his theory is correct. Basically, this is Cutler's theory. On a warm, sunny November day, just like this one in Dealey Plaza, a man held up an umbrella just as President Kennedy approached in his car. The man shot a dart into Kennedy's throat, the umbrella being the firing mechanism. Now, all this sounds a little far-fetched, but some researchers believe it, and they point to some hard evidence. First of all, the dart, or flechette. This dart was found in a Hartford gun show in 1977, and Cutler believes it is similar to the one allegedly fired at Kennedy. It is a matter of record that the CIA developed such a dart and a firing system for it. This man, Richard Bissell, an ex-CIA agent who lives in Farmington, confirms the weapon's existence. This is Bissell's home in Farmington. He refuses to talk to us on camera, saying he's too busy. But over the phone, he did tell me that the CIA did indeed have a dart or flechette weapon well before JFK was assassinated. So, in 1963, the umbrella firing dart did exist, and Cutler has made extensive drawings detailing how the dart could have been fired.
And so you're convinced that the Umbrella Man fired a flechette like this into President Kennedy's throat?
The reason I'm convinced is that this is exactly right. This 5 millimeter diameter is just about right for the observed 3 to 7 millimeter diameter of the actual throat wound, which is a small, round wound of entry. The doctors in Parkland said so.
Now, we know he got hit by something, like I said again, because he was grabbing his neck. Could the Umbrella Man have been a diversion or a distraction, and while something else went on right near him or next to him, that's possible. But for all we know, maybe he did fire something out of the umbrella. That sounds kind of Hollywood. But there's very good reason to believe that that's somewhat true. He got hit by something that certainly wasn't a high power rifle from far away, because it would have been a totally different scenario in that case. Like I said, it was almost stealth. Jackie didn't even know he got hit. Nobody knew he got hit. Same thing with Connolly. But he did get hit with something. It seems like it's very possible. And this guy, and then now that, and this, these people showing evidence of like a, of like that the, these weapons existed and were being bragged about. And frankly, if you go look on through the internet to see how much chatter there is about this thing, there certainly is a lot of information about this Umbrella Man. And like I said, they even chose to stick it in Seinfeld spoof, which is kind of interesting too. But so there's got to be some significance to that, and I'm gonna throw that out there that it looked to me like the Umbrella Man might have fired some flurried a bunch of darts or whatever mechanisms or whatever they call them, missiles, into the car. And there's evidence of that, and it certainly did happen the second they drove past that guy who was standing right there. So there you have it, the Umbrella Man. Keep it going.
There was one wingnut who published a book.
And then this guy's going to call him a wingnut again, and when they're trying to disparage him and discredit him. Again, it could be a layer of a taken debate deception, or it could be, or actually this could be the truth, and they're called, that's why they're calling him a wingnut. Either way, folks, I believe this is it's a significant thing, this whole Umbrella Man thing, even though it sounds crazy.
There was one wingnut who published a book with a diagram of the umbrella. The umbrella was rigged so that there was an aiming device, and there was a rocket tube that you could fire a flechette directly into Kennedy's throat.
The Umbrella Man is the real assassin.
Possibly.
In the handwritten autopsy released through the Freedom of Information Act, Dr. Malcolm Perry, one of the doctors on the scene in Dallas, is quoted as noting, "The massive wound of the head and a second puncture wound of the low anterior neck in approximately the midline." When this handwritten autopsy report was typed for official distribution, the word puncture was inexplicably taken out, and the word smaller put in its place. Soon after noting the puncture wound, Dr. Perry performed a tracheotomy on JFK, thereby obliterating the original neck wound. Today, the official government line is JFK was shot only from the rear, and his throat wound was an exit wound.
Which we know is ridiculous and isn't true, and they're calling it a puncture wound, and it's a smaller wound, and a lot of that stuff corroborates with the Umbrella Man. Keep it going.
He came forward, and he went to Washington with his umbrella, and he testified in 1978 before the House Select Committee on Assassinations. He explained then why he...
Okay, so he said 1978, so 15 years later, some guy... testifies in front of the Congress of Assassinations Board or whatever the hell they called it back then, and he's going to tell them a story of what he had the umbrella there for. It was 15 years later, and there's more than one person has said, which I didn't bother to put that in because of so many other clips I wanted you to focus on, but there were people who said that wasn't even the same guy, and several people said that. So who knows what the real true story is, but they certainly are pointing to this umbrella or giving credence to something to do with the umbrella. But listen to what this guy he tells Congress, and tell me this doesn't sound retarded.
He came forward, and he went to Washington with his umbrella, and he testified in 1978 before the House Select Committee on Assassinations. He explained then why he had opened the umbrella and was standing there that day. The open umbrella was a kind of protest, a visual protest. It wasn't a protest of any of John Kennedy's policies as president. It was a protest at the appeasement policies of Joseph P. Kennedy, John Kennedy's father, when he was ambassador to the court of St. James in 1938 and 39. It was a reference to Neville Chamberlain's umbrella. I read that and I thought, this is just wacky enough. It has to be true. And I take it to be true.
You see, when he laughed, I was like, oh, okay, he thinks that's as stupid as I think it sounds. And he's like, no, it's wacky enough to be true, and I believe it is true. Okay, why he's trying to tell you that it's true, I don't know, but that's a ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous...
What am I, a schmuck on wheels?
Sorry. Absolutely ridiculous explanation for something that's significant as the everybody in the limos hit with the minute they drive past this guy. There's a lot more significance than that to this umbrella thing, and the fact that he told that stupid story in front of Congress that Joseph P. Kennedy was at the St. James Court of St. James or whatever they call it, which is a British he's ambassador to a British mafiocracy corps or something like that, and talk about Nazis and this and Neville Chamberlain. That's nonsense, and it kind of lends more attention and credence to the idea that there's something going on much more nefarious than that with the Umbrella Man. As far as I can tell.
What am I, a schmuck on wheels?
Sorry. And keep it going.
A lot of people that day were deciding what was private, none of the American people's business. The chief pathologist, Commander Humes, by his own admission, voluntarily burned his autopsy notes. President Johnson orders the blood-soaked limousine filled with bullet holes and clues to be immediately washed and rebuilt. He sends John Connally's bloody suit right to the cleaners. The Justice Department denied this office access to the autopsy photos. And when we finally get a court order to examine President Kennedy's brain in the National Archives in the hopes of finding from which direction the bullet came from, we're told by the government, your government, that the president's brain has disappeared. That's not all that's disappeared, gentlemen. With it, I think, the concept of justice.
The evidence gathered during the assassination weekend was dispersed in many directions. The FBI had already begun to seize evidence at the scene. Secret Service agents seized the president's body before the required autopsy was performed.
Okay, so we got the doctor doing the autopsy, giving him a tracheotomy and destroying the evidence of the puncture wound. Then we have all kinds of evidence being destroyed, according to the Jim Garrison rendition in JFK, and then Mae Brussel will tell you that there's also lots of evidence being destroyed, with the Secret Service taking the body away and all these other things, as well, and so they're destroying evidence like immediately and thoroughly, which is exactly what happened again on 9/11. Which is because when these criminals pull these murderous acts, okay, you know, and we're all sitting around picking our noses and playing with our iPhones and thinking, oh yeah, we'll just believe, you know, just tell me more on TV and I'll believe that, and not asking any questions at all, and that's why they get away with these things, and they continue to get away with these things, and they're going to enslave your children, and you're gonna love it.
Where does the public's right to be secure override the public's right to know about something? Because in informing the public on a very sensitive matter, you're also informing the potential enemies of the United States. So I think you run into a philosophic conflict there. And I err on the side of protecting the security of the people.
Right. So that was John Tower, who was very well-known character in the I believe he's a senator. He's telling you, the public doesn't need to know everything because it's for their own protection. And he said, I would lean towards, you know, their security over them needing to know everything too much, you know. And that's.
We were specifically told not to discuss the case.
Right. So you don't need to know, and just go back to, you know, you're playing with your iPhone, you stupid slave, you idiot, and that's that.
The assassins are so much in power and the people are so lethargic that they can count on you out there to do very little.
Right. She said the assassins are in power, the people are lethargic, and they can count on you to do very little. Okay, which is, yeah, that's how it all goes down. And if you think that they're doing these things for fun and games, you're kidding yourself.
I'm telling you right straight out that if you are at all sensitive
If you're at all queasy, then don't watch this film. Just put on the late night movie, because this is very heavy. It's the film shot by the Dallas dress manufacturer Abraham Zapruder, and it's the execution of President Kennedy.
And you're going to see, without any doubt, William Grier shoot President Kennedy and kill that man in Dallas.
As the presidential car passes behind the freeway sign, President Kennedy is struck in the throat by a bullet. As he's grasping his throat, John Connolly is turning around to his...
Or he's struck in the throat by something. I don't know if it's a bullet, but he passes the sign, which, like I said, was where the umbrella man is standing, right there. You can see him, his umbrella, right next to the sign.
As the presidential car passes behind the freeway sign, President Kennedy is struck in the throat by a bullet. As he's grasping his throat, John Connolly is turning around to his right. He, at that point, is struck. You notice the passenger of the car turning back to see what has happened to the president. As he turns back to the front, the driver of the car turns with his left arm over his right shoulder with a pistol and fires.
William Grier did shoot the president. You can see him bring that weapon up across his chest, turn completely around in the seat, and fire at point blank range as he's facing directly at the president. Then you can see him bring that weapon back down across his chest. You'll see him hump down, grab the steering wheel, as Agent Kellerman humps down also. And then and only then does the car speed out of the kill zone.
Okay, so I will include the Zapruder film, a copy of the Zapruder film. I'll try to find the best and clearest one I can. I'll also try to get one that's a little bit in slow motion so you can see it. But if you focus on the driver, when he comes past that sign, you will see Kennedy's hit. He's waving to them right before he goes past the sign, which is a alteration of the video, obviously, but I will just leave it at that. He gets hit, okay, in his throat. He and Jackie looks at him like, what's wrong? And then the driver, William Grier, will turn 180 degrees around, literally stare right at Kennedy, bring his left arm up over his shoulder, and blasts him, okay? And you don't have to take my word for it. Watch the video. It's in there. It's clear as clear can be. Why haven't you seen it before? I don't know. That's because you're too busy believing everybody, like all garbage they tell you on TV about anti-Castro Cubans and communists and gangsters and mafiosos in Cuba and Sam Giancana and all these people. And so nobody on the media is going to tell you to watch the driver because the media is complicit and media is owned by the New World Order criminals. But if all you have to do is watch the video, it's going to be on my website, maxrat.com. I'm sure you can find it in dozens of other places. This is not my special version of it. You can go look up any Zapruder film video and you'll see it's in there, okay? William Grier, the driver of the car, turns 180 degrees around, points the gun at whatever weapon he has in his hand. It's a gun, but it might be a special gun. We're going to get into that a little bit, but it blows his head off. And then Jackie jumps out the car, running out the back, because the shooter's in the car, okay? That's the reason why she tried to jump out of the car. If the shooter was outside of the car, she would have ducked down to protect herself. No, she's trying to jump out of the car while it's moving. Anyway, William Grier turns around and blasts him. Keep it going.
William Grier did shoot the president. You can see him bring that weapon up across his chest, turn completely around in the seat, and fire at point-blank range as he's facing directly at the president. Then you can see him bring that weapon back down across his chest. You'll see him hump down, grab the steering wheel, as Agent Kellerman humps down also. And then and only then does the car speed out of the kill zone.
And now I'm going to show you, play a clip of William Grier himself lying out his ass about every single word out of his mouth, and I don't remember, and like he doesn't remember what happened on that day of all things. Okay, like he wasn't debriefed like 200 times, like people didn't ask him enough questions. No, he's going to tell you that he never even got interviewed by the FBI, and he doesn't remember what happened. I'm going to play those clips for you right now.
You told the commission that you really heard one shot this morning.
Well, I did. I didn't know at first that whether it was a shot or not. I thought it might be a motorcycle, policeman's motorcycle, but that's what I said. Mm-hmm. But then I said, when I looked over my shoulder and I saw the blood on the governor's shirt, you know, on his white shirt, then I knew it was bad or something else. Then I had an idea we were in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Well, how many times did you have a chance to glance back?
It was the one time. That was after the governor was hit.
I see. And did you see the president?
No, I didn't really see the president at all. See, I was, you know, I'm actually looking in front of you. I have a car in front of me. You can't turn around very much.
Okay, that's William Greer himself. The guy asked him, did you see the president? He says, first of all, he says he only turned around once. That's clearly not true because, again, you don't have to take my word for that. You just watch the Zapruder film. He turns around twice, period. And the second time he turns around, he brings his arm up and blasts him. And then he says he didn't even see the president, which is ridiculous because that's all he did was see the president. He turned right around and looked right at him twice. You can watch it right in the video. This is absolutely so he's why he's lying about this, and that's just that, folks. You gotta wait, get ready, because I got about five more lies out of this guy in a row, and they're all lying about it, and all the Secret Service guys are lying about it, because that's what happened. And again, you don't have to take my word for it. Just watch the video yourself. It's as clear can be. I've shown that video to dozens of people, friends of mine, and friends of friends, and I've never once seen anything but a shocked reaction, like, holy shit, he shot him right in the face. I'm like, I know, people are like, how come I never saw that before? And I'm like, because nobody ever, it took me years and years until Bill Cooper did that video about it, and I watched that one day. I was like, wow, it never even occurred to me. And certainly, once you see it, and you see what happened, and everything makes perfect. It's exactly what happened. I mean, it's so obvious. Okay, you can see it with your own eyes. And now I got William Greer lying about it all the live long day.
You told the commission that you really heard one shot this morning.
Well, I said I didn't know at first that whether it was a shot or not. I thought it might be a motorcycle, policeman's motorcycle.
All right, he thought it was a motorcycle. Whatever. Okay, what do you keep going? This guy's a trained Secret Service agent, okay? He's supposed to know what a gunshot sounds like, okay? And you want to argue with me and like, oh, not everybody knows? Whatever, that's what he's trained to. I don't know, but he's trained to know, okay? Period. And it's not a motorcycle backfire. Isn't that a convenient, stupid answer anyway, okay? Come on, guys.
When I looked over my shoulder and I saw the blood on the governor's shirt, you know, on his white shirt, then I knew it was bad or something else. Then I had an idea we were in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Well, how many times did you have a chance to glance back? It was the one time. That was after the...
Okay, that's a blatant lie. Check it yourself. He glanced back twice, okay? It's in the video again, so you can't... It's a blatant lie.
After the governor was hit.
I see. And did you see the president?
No, I didn't really see the president at all. See, I was... No, I'm actually looking in front of me. I have a car in front of me. You can't turn around very much.
Well, yeah, but he turned around and saw the president. He turned around 180 degrees, and there was a car in front of him. That's the car in his motorcade. It was like he's in traffic on the highway.
Inconsistencies regarding the actions of the people in the limousine have been a point of discussion among researchers. For example, the driver turns his head twice to look behind and then forward faster than physically possible, which seems to indicate removed frames.
Okay, and how do they know that? Because each frame, they say, is 1/18th of a second. And they show him turn around back and forth, like in each frame, he turns around like more or less two or three times, or two times. and that's physically impossible. So there, and there is, you can see it. It skips, it jumps. There's obviously frames removed because they don't want you to see how clearly he turns around and blasts Kennedy. And that's evident as you review the Zapruder film as well.
Keep your eyes on the driver. Remember, if you want to see who murdered a man, don't watch the man being murdered. Look around. In this instance, keep your eyes on the driver.
Okay, and I would hope that while you're listening to my show, you might play it along with the show and go look at that Zapruder film and take a look exactly what happened, and it'll all be very clear to you. Keep it going.
Did you remember seeing yourself on the film looking back at the present?
Well, right now I can't remember even what I did.
Okay, so that's William Greer again. He says, right now I can't remember what I saw. Okay, isn't that convenient, right now? What do you mean? What about later? No, right now I can't. Again, these are very shady answers and lying answers. I can't remember. He doesn't remember what happened on that day of all days. He was in the car driving it, and he wasn't asked questions over and over and over again. He's going to tell you, no, not even that. He's like, no, they didn't even ask me any questions. And we go, no, of course not.
And you'll notice, too, that when Mrs. Kennedy comes over after the first shot, she is directly in front of the president's face. And people have accused Bill Greer of pulling a gun out and shooting the president. He'd have had to shoot through the Connollys, and he'd have had to shoot Mrs. Kennedy.
Okay, that was Gerald Blaine again, who's a Secret Service agent again, who's on a book tour about his lying book, okay? And at the same time, they came out with In the Line of Fire, which was Clint Eastwood's portrayal of this guy, Gerald Blaine's buddy, Clint Hill, which is all, it's all a bunch of lies, okay? And this guy's going to tell you that, he would have had, you know, Jackie was blocking him, so he couldn't have shot him, which is a ridiculous, which doesn't make any sense. Well, whatever, that's a stupid answer, because all you have to do is watch the video, and you can see that she wasn't in his way, and he did shoot him, they're counting on your laziness, because you probably won't even go check what he just said. But if you do check what that guy just said, Gerald Blaine, that's a lie. He's caught in a lie, okay? And he's trying to debunk the story, and instead he's caught in a lie, okay? Period. Go check it for yourself. Don't believe me.
The driver had stopped. I don't know what was wrong with that driver.
Okay, there's a little hint in the JFK movie. She's like, I don't know what was wrong with that driver, and he stopped the car. I didn't get into the stopping the car thing, although there was a lot of testimony about that, and a lot of people saying he stopped the car and I do believe he did stop the car to a full stop when he turned around and blasted Kennedy. You could see people in the car being jolted forward, like he braked quickly and hard and right away, and because they all felt like they all went lunging towards the front of the car, everybody in the car at the same time. Not only that, But when Jackie's trying to get out of the car, it wasn't really moving. It started moving again the minute the guy Clint Hill, he wasn't even on the back of the car, and he runs up and jumps on the back of the car. So the car had to have been stopped, because or else he would have been chasing a moving car down the street. So they did stop the car again, but there was a little bit too much conjecture for me to really try to dwell too much on it. But so anyway, so in JFK, she's like, so the girl goes, well, I don't know what was wrong with that driver. Again, they're hinting at it for you.
I had a chance to review the film by Mr. Zapruder. Yeah. And of course, that tells the events of that day. Did you ever have a chance to see that film yourself?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Did that, if you look at it, did that seem like that was what happened that day as far as you were concerned?
Well, I can say my memory now, this is 7 years ago, I forgot what I really did see, what my comment would have been on the day, and I really wouldn't want to comment now.
He said he forgot what he saw, because it was seven years ago, he said, and he forgot what he saw, and I don't know if he said seven, because it was like, it would have to be longer than that, because he didn't even come out. Well, I mean, I don't know about that. Anyway, he said he forgot what he saw, and he forgot what his comment would be. Whatever that's supposed to mean. We'll play that one again for you real fast.
I had a chance to review the filmed by Mr. Zapruder. And of course that tells the events of that day. Did you ever have a chance to see that film yourself?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Did that, if you looked at it, did that seem like that was what happened on that day as far as you were concerned?
Well, I can say my memory now, this is 7 years ago, I forgot what I really did see, what my comment would have been on it, and I really wouldn't want to comment.
He forgot what he saw, and he forgot what his comment would have been. Whatever that's supposed to mean. Okay, another lying, shady answer. He forgot. How's he going to forget what happened on that day, of all days? Are you kidding me? So, so he's conveniently, oh, I don't remember, I forgot, I didn't know, I didn't see anything. I'm like, come on, my man, you're standing in the car, and like, and you're being accused of shooting the president yourself, and you're like, and everybody lets him go off with, oh, yeah, I forgot, or I didn't remember.
This is the key shot. The president going back and to his left. Shot from the front and right.
Okay, here's dozens of people saying shot from the front, Okay, here's a Dallas police chief who they tried to blame it on. The whole Dallas police, which is, again, way too low down for you to... Dallas police, this was being run out of the top of these CIA, FBI, and Secret Service. Nothing. Dallas police are little guys in this whole thing. So the Dallas police chief, look at what he says.
In my mind, and by the direction of the blood and brain from the president from one of the shots, it would just seem that it would have to be fired from the front rather than behind.
There you go. Everybody says that, and it's obvious it came from the front.
So the spit could have only come from the front and to the right.
But that's not what they would have you believe.
Now, this is an extreme blow-up of just the president from the film.
All right.
Coming out behind the sign, he's shot.
He's hit from
the front.
From the front, too.
From the front. Now, Jackie doesn't realize what's happened yet. She goes to his aid.
And now... He's hit
again, the violent backward motion.
Right, and again, violent back. He gets hit because he's hit from the front. So he gets jolted back by the kill shot.
Back and to the left. Back and to the left. Back and to the left. Back and to the left.
Which, by the way, that action you see Kennedy's head do in the Zapruder film? Caused by a bullet coming from up there.
Yeah, coming from up high and behind him. Yeah, if you watch the Greer shoot him, you'll see that everything he shoots him and he goes straight back hardly to the left, straight back from the exact same trajectory that the bullet came from or whatever he shot him with came from the front seat of the car. It's obvious as obvious can be. Just watch the video and you'll see for yourself.
Dr. Peters.
There was a large 7-centimeter opening in the right occipital parietal area. A considerable portion of the brain was missing there. Almost a fifth or possibly a quarter of the back of the head had been blasted out.
Okay, so the back of the head blasted out from a shot that came from the front.
What happened to your head when you got hit?
Well, my head went back
to the left. Say that again.
Back and to the left.
Back and to the left. Back and to the left.
So what are you saying?
I'm saying that the spit could not have come from behind. But there had to have been a second spitter.
The force of the shot drives him violently backward against the back of the seat. You see Mrs. Kennedy react in horror. The ugly gaping wound, which is evident here, according to many observers at the scene, was actually created on the print. This was not the actual nature of the wound. But you notice that Mrs. Kennedy wasted no time in trying to exit the vehicle because she clearly was able to determine exactly where that shot had originated, and it was her personal bodyguard, Clint Hill, another Secret Service agent, who attempted to keep her in.
Then I got up in the car, and Mrs. Kennedy at that time was coming out in the trunk. She was coming out in the trunk to try to retrieve something that came off the president's head, went off to the right rear.
Okay, that's Clint Hill, the Secret Service guy again, who's a liar, okay? And he's the guy who they portrayed in the In the Line of Fire movie with Clint Eastwood. And he's going to say, first of all, how does he know what she was doing? She was, if you watch the video again, she reacts instantly. Okay, there's no time for her to think. She's jumping out of the car, and he's like, no, she was going to retrieve brain matter. That's what we've been led to believe. That's so stupid, okay? That's not what happened. And why he, and how is he, and what, and so he has to plant that in your head. Why doesn't he, what is it, and why is he telling you that? What is he doesn't know that. He doesn't know what she's, he could really testify to is that, or tell you is that she was trying to get out the back of the car, or trying to go, she was on the back of the car, climbing, trying to get off the, you know, she was climbing on the trunk, okay, when the car was moving, going the other way. There's no indication that she was retrieving anything, and he forces her back in the car. Here we go. Let's play it again. Listen to him. And he's a liar.
Then I got up in the car.
And he's in the Secret Service.
And Mrs. Kennedy at that time was coming out on the trunk. She was coming out on the trunk to try to retrieve something that came off the president's head, went off to the right rear. She did not know I was there.
Okay, what does that mean? She didn't know I was there. What is that? So what is, what does that have to do with anything? Okay, again, that's just a weird, that's just show, it shows how scripted a liar he is. Okay, what do you mean she didn't know he was there? So what? All right, so well, she wouldn't have tried to jump out the back of the car? No, she was trying to jump out the back of the car anyway.
When I get up in the trunk, I pushed her as best I could back into the rear seat.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. Thanks, buddy.
I've seen all the evidence of that, and I was in the morgue. I saw where everybody was hit, and everyone was hit from the rear. Mm-hmm. I mean, the president, the shots that hit him were from the rear. The one that hit the governor was from the rear.
Okay, so here's an interesting one. William Greer getting caught lying again. He said he was in the morgue, and he saw where everybody was shot. Meanwhile, there was only one person dead, okay? And second of all, okay, so how do you know where Connolly's not in the morgue? He's not, he didn't die, okay? So how did he know where Connolly was shot, okay? Now, what is he, a doctor now? What is he, like, he was inspecting the wounds? He was inspecting the bullet holes? In the morgue, he's a driver of the fucking car. Okay, so that's ridiculous. Okay, well, I doubt very seriously he was in the morgue, but even if he went, what is he, in the morgue inspecting the fucking wounds on fucking Kennedy? Are you kidding me? Okay, and only that, but then he's like, everybody was hitting the rear. I'm like, first of all, there's only two people hit, supposedly. It was Kennedy and Connolly, and Connolly's not in the morgue. All right, so again, and he's a liar, and he's a driver of the fucking car. He's not a fucking coroner or anything of the sort. And you want to argue with me about that? Then go argue with me about that and be an idiot, okay? Because there's no, this guy's a driver of the fucking car, okay? When they drop the body or whatever, that's it, okay? He doesn't go into the morgue and such, and hey, let me take a look at the holes in his head for, you know, no. And not only the morgue, but they didn't bring him to the morgue first anyway. It just doesn't make any sense, okay? And again, that's because this guy is not in the know in that category anyway, and he just has no expertise in that area. And it just doesn't make any sense. You want to tell me, oh, how do you know that's not possible? I didn't say it's not possible. That just didn't happen, okay? And, you know, you can't believe this garbage from liars, okay? I'm sorry.
Well, they never interviewed me. I never was interviewed by the FBI, never.
You're being played for a fool.
Well, they never interviewed me. I never was interviewed by the FBI, never.
Never interviewed by the FBI. He's a driver of the car, and he's never interviewed? Never? You don't think that would be standard procedure to interview everybody, like, just to get, like, a little bit of information out of them? No, never. Okay, that's it. Again, that has to be a lie. And that's it. Oh, no, and they never interviewed me.
Well, they never interviewed me. I never was interviewed by the FBI, never.
Okay, so, actually, I made a little quick compilation of all the, because of this interview that they did with William Greer. He basically just saying, I don't remember, or that nothing happened, or I didn't know, I don't know, that, or no to everything, and nothing happened, and they never interviewed me, except, and never interviewed me, or and I don't remember anything, and denying everything, But he remembers like, you know, the head wounds, and you know, he remembers that everybody that Kennedy got hit in the rear of the head, or got all the shots came from the rear, or that's the only thing he, so all he is a convenient memory for the lies that they're trying to pump to you to deflect the attention off of that he shot Kennedy, and that he's working for the New World Order criminals who are running everything and are absolutely evil, and we need to fucking all come together and get rid of this scum.
I didn't know at first that it was a shot, and I thought it might be a policeman's motorcycle, but that's what I said.
Did you see the president?
No, I didn't really see the president at all. All of that's in the report. Yeah, I think they said, I forgot. I can't say my memory now. This was 7 years ago. I forgot what I really did see, what my comment would have been on it, and I really wouldn't want to comment. Well, I forgot what I did see. Well, right now, I can't remember even what I did see. He didn't get out now. He just stayed in the car and shook hands with people, I believe. If he got out, I don't remember. No, I don't believe I remember to see a photograph. I've seen all the evidence of that, and I was in the morgue. I saw where everybody was hit, and everyone was hit from the rear. I mean, the president, the shots that hit him were from the rear. The one that hit the governor was from the rear.
It's stated in those documents that the assassination pistol used was prepared, manufactured specifically by the Central Intelligence Agency for assassinations. It was electrically operated, gas-powered, and could either fire a poison dart, a small hypodermic needle, or an exploding pellet, which could contain any one of several deadly poisons. These documents stated that William Greer, the driver of the president's car, a Secret Service agent, an ex-chauffeur of the Lodge family, turned in his seat and fired with this assassination pistol at point-blank range at the president's head. An exploding pellet filled with shellfish toxin, which really killed our president.
Okay, I threw that in there. So Bill Cooper said that he had the highest classification of when he worked in the Office of Naval Intelligence in the Navy, and which is a very high ranking. And he said he saw a document that explained that they have a special CIA gun and that they use this poison that it shoots it with pellets from or the exploding pellets from the gun. Now you know, and you would think like, okay, that sounds kind of far fetched, what do you have to back up that? But then I'm going to show you clips and clip after clip of people in like Walter Mondale, John Tower, Barry Goldwater. I mean, like the top people, William Colby, who was the head of the CIA at the time, or right before that, or after that, actually. And like the top people in government having a discussion at this assassination meeting that they have, and they bring out the gun and they talk about this shellfish toxin, which sounds far fetched. Now, could all that be a bunch of hype? Sure, but it certainly did get a lot of attention, and they certainly wanted us to believe that. Either way, Kenny got hit in the throat with something, and he got blasted with something, okay? But I'll just throw it in there. I'm going to let these things run. I'm going to keep moving on the show.
It's stated in those documents that the assassination pistol used was prepared, manufactured specifically by the Central Intelligence Agency for assassinations. It was electrically operated, gas-powered, and could either fire a poison dart, a small hypodermic needle, or an exploding pellet, which could contain any one of several deadly poisons. These documents stated that William Greer, the driver of the president's car, a Secret Service agent, an ex-chauffeur of the Lodge family, turned in his seat and fired with this assassination pistol at point-blank range at the president's head. An exploding pellet filled with shellfish toxin, which really killed our president. Now you're going to see the gun, and you're going to see proof that they used shellfish toxin, and that the CIA had both of these in their possession.
What the hell kind of gun is that?
Something I made.
No kidding?
You made it? Guess he's paying for it, huh? Can I see it? Shit, it's light.
Yeah,
it's light. What's it made of?
It's composite, like plastic.
Pretty neat.
That was a clip from In the Line of Fire again, where the guy who's going to kill the president now may has his own little assassination gun that he made himself.
I was told to bring the this gun that we had developed.
Okay, this is William Colby himself. He's running the CIA. He said the gun we had developed.
And never used on people. I was told...
We never use it on people. I don't know. Take his word for it. He's in the CIA.
Bring the this gun that we had developed and never used on people.
Have you brought with you... They
use it on people. They used it on... they were shooting squirrels with that.
Some of those devices which would have enabled the CIA to use this poison for...
We have indeed.
For killing people... Don't point it at me.
So they put the gun out there right on the table in front of everybody. They show everybody the gun in the Congress hearing.
Dr. Everett Hennell, a microbiologist at Fort Detrick for 3 decades, worked in association with the CIA.
These are what we call Class 3 cabinet systems. They're gas-tight systems for working with almost complete safety with any infectious diseases, toxins, things such as the shellfish toxin. They're very toxic indeed, particularly when highly purified. And I understand that these could be placed on steel needles and fired with air guns into an animal and induce death almost immediately. So that they were apparently a very effective, or could be a very effective type of covert weapon.
Yeah, for animals.
You were specifically asked about shellfish toxins and shellfish poisons. You say it's inconceivable that a secret intelligence arm of the government has to comply with all the overt orders of the government. Is that an accurate quote or not an accurate quote?
Well, if it's accurate, it shouldn't have been said.
Well, now, I... So, looks like we're on plausible denial again, is all I can say here, Mr. Chairman.
Now, there was a printed report that a couple of FBI agents had interviewed you also.
No, they never interviewed me. I never was interviewed by the FBI, ever.
Never.
William Greer did shoot President Kennedy in Dallas.
Watch the left side of your screen. The arrow points to Agent in Charge, Amory Roberts, as he stands in the Secret Service follow-up car and motions with his hand. What he is doing is calling away the President's 2 most important bodyguards, the bodyguards whose job was to protect the President's back by riding on the bumper of the limousine throughout the motorcade.
Okay, so the car, the limousine, had special, like, handles and special foot spots for the Secret Service guys to ride on the car, on the limo. And they show a video where they were on the back of the car, and then this guy who's in the Secret Service car behind the President's limo motions to them to get off the car, and they jump off the car. That video will be included in the show, on my webpage too. And the guy gestures like very dramatically, like 3 times, like, what, what are you doing, what are you talking about? So that was very theatrical, and there was, he gestured on purpose, and then wait to hear what the lying Clint Hill says about his explanation for why they jumped off the back of the car, okay? Which is, it's comical, and it's ridiculous, and that shows you, again, I'm not sure how much, so I'm going to include that video again where they all get off the car, and so there's nobody who's supposedly there to protect the president riding on the car. Those guys leave the car before Kennedy goes down the block and gets killed. Here we go, and let me just keep it going.
Watch the left side of your screen. The arrow points to Agent in Charge, Amory Roberts, as he stands in the Secret Service follow-up car and motions with his hand. What he is doing is calling away the President's 2 most important bodyguards, the bodyguards whose job was to protect the president's back by riding on the bumper of the limousine throughout the motorcade.
Butte wanted to station agents on his bumpers and sideboards. He refused.
Right, so in the movie In the Line of Fire, and also in these guys' book, Blaine and Gerald Blaine, the two people I have interviewed, and Clint Hill wrote a book, and they're all like, no, the president told us not to put the, he didn't want the people on the car, which is, and they give you a ridiculous story about that. I'm going to give that all to you in their own words. Keep it going.
When we turn left on Elm, right in front of the school book depository, there were very few people on the left, few people on the right. There was no reason to be on the back of the car, and we knew we were about to hit the Stebbins Freeway.
Now, there's no reason to be on the back of the car. Everything was fine. We were just turning left on Elm. You know, what does that mean? There's no reason to be on the back of the car except for that's your job, I guess, you know. And that's why they built handles onto the back of the car. And again, I don't think that this don't think would have changed anyway, except that. But it just shows you how what kind of hanky panky is going on and why. And they got a bunch of Secret Service people lying about everything. And I'm going, well, just keep it going from there. So there was no reason, he said, to be back on the car.
When we turned left on Elm, right in front of the school book depository, there were very few people on the left, few people on the right. There was no reason to be on the back of the car, and we...
Wait, so he's like, there was no people there. You know, there's only a few people on the left, nobody on the right. So whenever there's no people there, they jump off the car, and then when there's a couple people they're going to drive past, they jump back on again? That's not... Come on, guys. And they're like, yeah, there's no reason to be on the car. There's no reason to put the handles and the foot things on the car either. You know, I guess why don't they just take those off and put them back on whenever they need those too? Whatever. This is nonsensical. Keep it going. And he's a liar, and he's propagating the lie in the media. So for you morons to gobble up and say, oh yeah, he's in jail of me about you. See, Max, he said there was no reason to be on the car. Yeah, okay, fine.
Knew we were about to hit the Stebbins Freeway and Expressway, and we were going to go at freeway speeds, which meant there wouldn't be agents on the back of the car anyway. So there were no agents on the back of the car at the time the incident occurred, but it was partly because we were about to hit a freeway and partly because he didn't want them there.
Okay, so he didn't want him there, and he's like, "And hey, we're about to hit the freeway, so we don't want to be on the back of the car when he hits the freeway." I'm like, "Come on, what kind of stupid explanation is that?" And you want to take that guy's that stupid explanation for things and why they weren't protecting the president? Because they're like, "Oh, we're hitting the freeway, so we all jumped off the back of the car." And this guy's getting way worse than that. Wait to hear the next one.
They're lying to us again, Larry. Come on, you're a Princeton graduate. You should know how they do it.
Okay, and here's Gerald Blaine, the guy who wrote the book with Clint Hill. Again, he's saying he's going to blame it on the president. Saying, well, the president told us he doesn't want the... he said the president doesn't want us on the car because it's going to ruin his image, he said, of some crap.
President Kennedy said, look, his political style was to go out and shake hands with the people, to greet them, and so forth, and... Floyd had evidently had a discussion with him on the way down there, and he said, Floyd, if I didn't get out and shake hands with the people, I couldn't get elected dog catcher. And so he said, for this trip and the trip down in Texas, I don't want the agents riding on the back of the car.
Okay, so he's going to say that if he wants to shake the people's hands, he said the president said he wants to shake the people's hands, so the people riding in the back of the car are going to get in the way? That's some nonsense again, and so they're going to blame Kennedy for his own assassination now. Isn't that nice?
Watch the left side of your screen. The arrow points to agent in charge, Amory Roberts, as he stands in the Secret Service follow-up car, motions with his hand. What he is doing is calling away the president's two most important bodyguards, the bodyguards whose job was to protect the president's back by riding on the bumper of the limousine throughout the motorcade.
Okay, and here is the clip of the show.
And what he was doing was, when he came back off the car, he was saying, okay, you guys, I'm going to lunch. Have a good trip. I talked to him within the last month. And he reiterated to me the same thing again. That's exactly what he was doing. Just making a gesture to us in the follow-up car. See ya. I'm going to lunch. Have a good trip.
What a liar.
What am I, a schmuck on wheels?
Okay, so now. So they, I will show you the clip of the vid will be included in the show. You're going to watch a guy jump off the back of the car because he was motioning to get off. And then and he's going to make this, this stupid gesture like, what? And then and this guy is going to tell you, he's Clint Hill. He's the guy who's riding on the back of the car who's supposedly there to protect Jackie Kennedy. And wrote a book about how it's Kennedy's fault for his own assassination. And then he's going to say that the guy, the reason the guy jumped off the back of the car is because it was lunch break. Okay, so in other words, they're driving down the street in Dallas, okay, and they're on the back of the car protecting the president, supposedly, and he, when he's looking at his watch, he's like, oh, lunchtime, and jumps off the back in the middle of the fucking parade, car parade, or as Kennedy goes down there, and, you know, he's like, oh, lunch break, see you later, guys. Are you kidding me? And and they're going to tell you that? Like, that's some absurd garbage, and you're going to believe it? Are you going to believe that? Anyway.
What am I, a schmuck on wheels?
Sorry. Okay, let's just listen to that one more time, and then we're going to move on. That's how stupid they think you are, and how stupid, and this is a guy who's a culprit, okay? This guy who's I believe is part of the murder of the president, and he's going to give you a stupid answer like that? This guy should go to jail for that right now. He's on TV telling you garbage like that, like you're an absolute moron?
And what he was doing was, when he came back off the car, he was saying, okay, you guys, I'm going to lunch. Have a good trip. I talked to him within the last month.
Oh, yeah, he talked to him, and he confirmed that that's what he said he was doing. I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, so you want to believe that? And that's what that guy told. Clint Hill himself told you on TV? You got to be kidding me.
And he reiterated to me the same thing again. That's exactly what he was doing. Just making a gesture to us in the follow-up car. See ya. I'm going to lunch. Have a good trip.
And the guy's laughing because that sounds so absurd. But you know, why don't you just kick him off the show and say, get the fuck out of here, you fucking liar.
One of the things that critics say about the book is that it's an attempt by you all to blame President Kennedy for what happened down there because of the idea that you couldn't ride on the side of the actual limousine that was shot.
It's exactly what they're trying to do, which is ridiculous, okay? And that's how they do. That's how stupid they think you are. And you're going to believe, you know, that Oswald did it and shot him from the book depository through the trees, from behind. No evidence of any of that. And then you're going to believe that this garbage about the guys like that. Oh, Kenny told us not to ride on the car. That's what, and he had to go to lunch.
The driver of the car was not supposed to turn around, nor was he supposed to draw a weapon. He was supposed to get that car out of the kill zone as quickly and as efficiently as possible. The agent in the front seat was supposed to draw his gun, attempt to discover the assassins, and return fire. Neither one of those two men did what they were trained to do.
If the Secret Service driving the limousine was involved, who else was involved? If the Secret Service, FBI, or CIA, who all had possession of the original Zapruder film, were involved in its alteration, what does that mean? If Time Life, which immediately bought the rights to the film and then refused to show it for decades, was involved, what does that mean?
Exactly, and that's why they don't want you to know the Secret Service did it. That's why they don't want you to know that the CIA, Secret Service, FBI, and all these high-level government agencies that are law enforcement oriented. They don't want you to realize that you're being controlled by the New World Order Rockefeller murdering criminals and they control the military. They don't want you to know that, so they're gonna tell you, oh, it's San Giancana did it, or anti Castro Cubans did it, or communists did it, or Lee Harvey Oswald's a lone gunman did it. That you see but no. If the Secret Service was involved, that means, you know, that doesn't mean you know who did it, okay? It was high-level criminals within the who took over our government in a coup d'etat, okay? And that's what happened, folks. Keep it going.
You know he threatened to kill the president.
We didn't think he was serious.
after you turned up that fingerprint.
But you knew, you and the FBI.
I understand your frustration.
You understand my frustration, you pompous son of a bitch. What the fuck did Larry do for you anyway? Run coke for the Contras, sell arms to Iran?
Okay, that's Clint Eastwood. He's the Secret Service guy, and he's still yelling at the CIA guys. What are you guys all selling coke, running coke and drugs and stuff like that? So, and you know, the Secret Service guys are honorable.
He had ordered the intelligence community and the CIA specifically to cease importing and selling illegal narcotics, drugs to the American people in order to finance their black projects.
Okay, so Bill Cooper's going to tell you that JFK ordered the CIA to cease dealing drugs to the American people. I'll take that with a little bit of a grain of salt, but so they're going to indicate that the CIA and the people who run the CIA have a good reason to be mad at JFK as well, which is true.
Well, many of the people in the CIA have been trained to lie. That's their job, to spread propaganda overseas.
He had also threatened publicly to disband the Central Intelligence Agency and scatter it to the thousand winds.
Right, and the CIA is basically a secret army run by the New World Order criminals again to wreak havoc on the peoples of the world, and it's all in secret, and we pay for it. Isn't that nice?
The Pentagon Papers can show you without a doubt, and other documents will show you that John Kennedy intended the troops out of Southeast Asia by 1964.
Okay, so there's clear evidence that JFK wasn't gonna continue on with the stupid Vietnam War.
The war is not meant to be won. It is meant to be continuous. The essential act of modern warfare is the destruction of the produce of human labor. A hierarchy of society is only possible on the basis of poverty and ignorance. In principle, the war effort is always planned to keep society on the brink of starvation. The war is waged by the ruling group against its own subjects, and its object is not victory over Eurasia or East Asia, but to keep the very structure of society intact.
Can't have anybody who's not all the way, all in on the pro-war thing, because the wars are the way, it's the health of the state, it's the way the power structure maintains its power and control over everybody, because just like Winston said, and that was in 1984, that's anywhere you look, any rational thought, any kind will tell you that the war is only to maintain the control over the stupid people who allow it, okay, and because we're too busy, we'd rather be distracted with an iPhone, because we don't care if they're a bunch of murderers that are using our tax money to murder people and control people within in our own name. Like, that's not going to come back and haunt us, which it does, and it will go further than that, okay, because we're going to go into a totalitarian world dictatorship, which is going to be more problems to get out of that, and then lots of people are going to get killed.
He had ordered also the printing of real money, again, silver certificates, backed by real silver money. And we also know that that would have broken the back of the Federal Reserve.
Who runs the Federal Reserve? New World Order criminals. Federal Reserve is a outright scamming group. Okay, they print our money. They're a private corporation. Okay, they're not. It's not a public entity, the Federal Reserve, and Kennedy was talking about backing money with silver again. Couldn't have that either. He was coming after these people. That's why they killed him.
We've narrowed the gap to 5 points. We can't let up now.
We'll have to change our procedures. Move them around in unmarked cars. Frisk everyone within 50 yards.
Frisk people going into $10,000 plate dinners. You're overreacting again, Oregon.
If I don't overreact, the president's dead.
Okay, so again, that's Clint Eastwood in the Line of Fire, where his suggestion is, well, you know, how are we going to protect people better now? Well, just frisk everybody. There you go. That's pretty. Yeah, just listen. You know, we need more police state to protect the people against the murdering New World Order criminals. No. That's not going to help because they're the one. We're the people that are protecting us are the ones who are killing us and using a totalitarian ruling over us.
Many Americans who were not even suspected of crime were not only spied upon, but they were harassed, they were discredited, and at times endangered.
And suddenly it all began to roll out. The IRS was targeting thousands of Americans for tax investigations in order to chill activity on their part that they didn't like. The U.S. Army was conducting surveillance of civilians in civilian life. There was a whole pattern of this running throughout government. And it was, of course, once you saw what was going on, it was a shock. We saw the tip of an iceberg that could have destroyed American liberty.
Well, that's that tip of the iceberg is the iceberg is ubiquitous and it's giant, and so now they're using the IRS to intimidate people. They're all on the oh, that's because you know we have to protect you, and who runs is the IRS a private corporation incorporated in the state of Delaware? Yes, it is, folks. Check that one for yourself too. Are they the collection arm of the criminal Federal Reserve that's also private? Yes, they are. Okay, so now because they killed the president, now they're going to use the IRS to intimidate us, and they're going to bring in police state on us, and we're going to frisk everybody because of that. Isn't that nice?
Look, Larry, I know what you look like. I've seen your eyes.
My eyes might look different next time.
Not what's behind them won't.
Okay, that's the Secret Service guy. That's Clint Eastwood saying, I can tell you're a criminal from your eyes. Okay, and so you know what though? Now you know what? You got those guys. If a Secret Service guy decides you got bad eyes, you're going to jail for that, buddy.
You're a thought criminal.
Right. You know what? You're in jail for thought crime too.
We have here at home the rise of a domestic police state.
We see the emergence within the Western European countries, particularly the United States, Canada, Britain, Australia, we see the emergence of a police state apparatus.
Okay, and as I come down the backstretch for this JFK assassination show, I think we're all getting the you're getting it all here. I really enjoy this show. I enjoy doing this show. I learned a lot about things myself, but isn't it all so fitting all into place for you, especially as you listen to any of my other shows, you'll see how isn't this all just fitting right into place, and how this has been going on and I wonder at what point will anybody wake up?
Yes, you're living in a police state. Your government is evil.
All collectivist systems eventually deteriorate into a police state.
The system was set up after the political assassination of John Kennedy to bring in more repressions. And then in 1968, after the assassination of Robert Kennedy, national security and wiretapping and surveillance increased even more.
My government will continue to reduce crime and protect national security. Legislation will be introduced to reform the way in which offenders are rehabilitated in England and Wales. Legislation will be brought forward to introduce new powers to tackle antisocial behaviour, cut crime, and further reform the police.
Antisocial behaviour. I might have to be worried about that.
Gradually completing the transition into state socialism and of converting the increasing and tightening regimentation into the framework of a totalitarian police state.
He didn't talk about CIA agents and data banks and computerized police and social security numbers that marked everybody from the day they were born, or the fingerprinting of law students.
because they're such cheaters before they even apply for school. They lie so much, they're fingerprinted, mail open, surreptitious entry, wiretapping, bugging, eavesdropping, covert operations against mankind. That wasn't what he had in mind. That's what we have at the end of 10 years.
Right, so she said that that's not what Kennedy had in mind, but that's what we got after the end of 10 years since his death. We got wiretapping, checking people's mail. Now it's emails. IRS intimidation. All these things, all as a result of them killing our president. And the same people who are killing your president are going to wiretap you and rob you and intimidate you with the IRS and then steal your money as well with the IRS and then say, well, we're helping you out. Yeah, that's all for your own good because we killed your president. Okay, and say, now it's 9/11. The same. It's even worse. Okay, no, it's like we knocked down the building 9/11. So now we have to now we have to stop and frisk you on the street because you're a terrorist now, even though the terrorists are the ones who are stopping and frisking you. This is sick. And people are like, sorry, Max, I'm diddling with my iPhone right now. I'm busy. Don't have time to listen to your crap.
The United States is a police state that masquerades as a democracy.
Okay, and coming down the backstretch of this show, I'm on the last few clips here. Why don't I just try to give you a quick summary of what we went through. Kennedy was hit twice, okay, or at least. The first one was that neck shot. I'm going to say that wasn't a bullet or some sort of a projectile that is very possible it could have been some poison dart or a dart or some sort of a shot from that umbrella. If it wasn't shot from that umbrella, it certainly came from that exact vicinity. Maybe the umbrella was a diversion while somebody else was doing it. I don't know. It was obviously in that same place where they put that fake street sign. The reason I think it's fake is if you look at it, it's literally parallel to the road. Parallel meaning you'd have to turn your head 90 degrees to the right to see the sign, which would be take your eyes off the road, which is not how street signs are placed, to say the least. Okay, there's 10 different things wrong with it. I could show you the analysis where I'll probably stick that in the show notes also, where they discuss all the alterations of the video. So they came past that sign. Kennedy's hit. They called it a flurry of bullets or a flurry of projectiles into the car. Connolly gets hit. They say it hit 7 different places in their body. That explains that rather than an undamaged, pristine, condition bullet that popped. Not only does it go through 2 people, hit him 7 times in different places, taking different directions, but then, pops out of the body and lays next to him on the gurney. If you want to believe that, again, I'm selling, swampland in the Everglades at a good price, and I'll sell it all to you if you want to believe that. And I'll tell you that all I have to do, I'll tell you, you'll make a lot of money on it if you want to believe that too. Then the driver of the car, William Greer, turns around with his left hand, puts it up, points it right at the president, stares right at him, and blasts him, okay? You can look at the Zapruder film. It's clear as clear can be. Who did it? Obviously, if it's the CIA and the Secret Service and the FBI are all lying to you about it, and the Secret Service guy did it, you'd see with your own eyes, that shows you that this came from very high places. It's the same people who do all these crimes, okay? That's obvious can be. Then they put the Dulles and McCoy, both people who work for Chase Manhattan Bank are on the Warren Commission. Isn't that convenient, okay? Those are Rockefeller-based criminals, okay? Who's running the New World Order? The Rockefellers, okay, and the Queen of England and their buddies. Those are the people who have the best, biggest interest, who benefit the most, and who have the power to cover this all up. Those are the people who did it, okay, period. And I'm going to wrap this show up. I'm coming down the back stretch here. thanks once again for listening to my show about the John F. Kennedy assassination. Hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to play a bunch of clips and we're going to wrap this show up. I'll be back with you. I'm going to play a few clips for you.
I'll bet you that brown pigeon down there flies off before the white one.
How do you know?
I know things about pigeons.
Okay, so that's supposedly the guy from, that's Clint Eastwood again from Line of Fire. He says, I bet you the brown pigeon flies off before the white one. I'm not sure what type of racial undertones you want to tell, you know. I think that that's twisted to me, but, and I just threw that in there at the end because, like, that's just, I don't know why they want, they just want to let you know, but by the way, not, you know, not only am I working for New World Order criminals, but by the way, if you didn't remember that, the New World Order criminals are eugenicist, racist, black murder people murdering criminals and white people and murdering in general criminals, and then there you go. I know pigeons, and what do you mean the brown people fly away, run away faster than the white people do? I'm not sure what that means. Okay, I'll play it again. We'll keep it going for the end of the show.
I'll bet you that brown pigeon down there flies off before the white one.
How do you know?
I know things about pigeons.
He tried to elevate our minds to the highest of what we're capable of doing instead of hiding a lot of the things that we know go on. He didn't praise all the filthy, dirty tricks that we do know exist in this world. He elevated or tried to elevate the mind to people who have higher methods of living so that somebody can emulate those systems.
That was Mae Brussel talking about JFK.
I think we can do better. I don't want the talents of any American to go to waste. I know that there are those who say that we want to turn everything over to the government. I don't at all. I want the individuals to meet their responsibilities.
That's a very responsible thing to say.
Most people want to belong to their peer group. They want to be the same as everyone else when it comes to opinions. In fact, they judge their own personal sanity by bouncing ideas off their neighbors and friends who will answer back and agree on these same topics in kind. It doesn't matter if the topics or what you're given are facts or utter nonsense. As long as everyone agrees at the same time, you'll say, well, I'm sane. And your friends will all agree because they've had the same information given to them.
Oh, by the way, so here's Martin Luther King. The day after JFK was killed, here's this little interview with him. Got a couple more clips left, and we're going to wrap this show up.
You have had attempts made on your life and have been threatened perhaps even tonight. What is it like to walk under this constant threat?
Well, it's often difficult, but when you live with it so long, you almost become immune to being afraid as a result of these threats. I guess you have to come to the point of looking at these things philosophically, and this is where I have decided to stand. I believe firmly that this cause is right, and that someone must have the courage and the fortitude to stand up for it, even if it means suffering or even if it means death. And I have always felt that unmerited suffering is redemptive. And even if I have to die for this cause, if physical death is the price that others have to pay, then it is the price that is paid to free the soul of our nation and to free our children from a permanent spiritual death. And in this sense, I think it is very redemptive, or it can be, even if it occurs.
I hope that I've educated you. Please don't believe anything that I've said. Believe your own gut, your own eyes, your own research. And God bless you.
My disgust is at a different level of the educational system, the schools, the social science teachers, the political science teachers, and the parents and families who lie to their children. They lie about the conspiracies, the evidence. They don't discuss or have conversations. They prefer to put the kids in front of the tube instead of sharing what's happening.
And that's the end of the show, folks. It's November 28th. It's Thanksgiving morning. I want to thank you all for listening to the show. I want to wish everybody and my friends and family and all my listeners a absolutely wonderful Thanksgiving. And God bless all of you and all the best, everybody. And thanks once again for coming aboard the Max Rat Deconstruction Zone. I'm Max Rat, and I'm over and out.
If I don't come back, you tell Mother I love her.
Your mother's dead, Llewellyn.
Well, then I'll tell her myself.
Batmobile over and out.